Not too long ago, I was blessed with this absolute gem of a comment on my YouTube video. Doobie dooba, DB, Indian man voice can't understand. At first, I thought this was just a one-off thing, somebody poking fun at an Indian accent. How bad could it be? But boy, was I wrong.
Replace the T with a D equal Indian? Really?
And I can only imagine him saying it with an Indian accent, which makes it more funny than embarrassing.
Don't?
Because online, people are just looking for any reason to be racist.
Don't tell me what to do!
A bit further down the rabbit hole, and I discovered that some of my other Asian counterparts were also subjected to this mockery. Supplies! So today, I am in Glasgow at the University of Strathclyde, and I'm here to meet an expert about speech and accents. There's clearly more to accents than what first meets the eye, and I want to explore exactly what it is. And hopefully she will be able to help me understand, why do I speak the way that I do? Let's figure it out.
Can I ask the Honourable Gentleman what work is being done to make sure that this place is more accessible, particularly for some of our colleagues who have a disability?
Hear, hear.
I'm sorry. It must be something to do with my Antipodean background. Could you please repeat the question, because I didn't follow it.
Accents are a very curious thing. We are speaking the same language, yet we sound so different. Sometimes so different that we question whether we are speaking the same language at all.
I'm saying that a number of parliamentary colleagues who have disabilities do find it quite difficult getting around certain parts of the state. Given that we're doing this refurbishment work, what can be done to make sure that those with a disability are able to move around more freely and the place is accessible?
I'm really sorry. Please, could you do it very slowly and intimidating English?
This video never ceases to amaze me. Two members of the parliament of the same country struggling to understand each other in a language that they invented.
So accents are kind of constellations of different aspects of speech. So you have something that's more systemic, if you like, to do with system. So you can have like an inventory of speech sounds, and that might be different in one accent compared to another accent, comparing Scottish English with Anglo-English. So Anglo-English has more vowel sounds than Scottish English. Conversely, Scottish English has two more consonant sounds than Anglo-English has. So we have the ch sound, which is the sound that you get in a word like loch, and that used to be part of Anglo-English and it was lost. And the other one is the wh sound. So if you take two words, whales, the marine mammals, and whales, the country, these are homophones in Anglo-English.
Wine, 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 wine.
Accents are a complex mix of different elements of speech. A collection of sound in one accent can come across very differently in another accent. That kind of also highlights the very unique qualities of each accent.
Maybe one of the biggest differences between, or different categorical differences between accents of English is rhoticity and non-rhoticity. So this is to do with whether R can occur after a vowel. So for Anglo-English and Australian English, South African English, New Zealand English, these are all non-rhotic accents. And they would have, if they said the word car, so me, I have an R at the end, they would say car. So they just have a long vowel. American and North American and Scottish English, we still have the R sound, so we would say car. So that's a kind of structural difference.
Another factor could be the intonation and the tempo with which people speak. More often than not, it is borrowed from the native languages, which I can demonstrate by this example over here. So this is Kimi Raikkonen, a Finnish Formula One champion. Let's listen to him talking in English.
Well, that's how it has turned out to be, so, you know, I'm sure in the future it will change, but that's...
Now let's listen to him talking in Finnish.
Oli joku sääntö tullut yhtäkkiä, että kaikkien pitää lähteä täyden sadekkelin renkaalla, mutta meidän tiimille unohti kertoa semmoinen.
I guess you can draw the similarities between the way Kimi speaks in Finnish and the way that he speaks in English. But what stands out as perhaps the most subtle is the difference in phonetics.
If you see the word level.
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 Yes.
So you have a clear L,
yes.
I have a dark L, level. So my tongue is further back, your tongue is higher in fronter.
The tongue is a very important part of speech. It dictates the way that we sound far more effectively than we realize. Dr. Lawson and her colleagues have employed a brilliant technique using ultrasound for visualizing the movement of the tongue while speaking.
So, if you place the probe under your head, oriented to this way, you can see like a slice in the middle of your tongue, and you can see how my tongue's wiggling about there. So if I say ta-ta-ta-ta, ka-ka-ka-ka-ka, you can see the two different parts of the back and the front part of the tongue and how they articulate.
So this is what my tongue looks like with an ultrasound. So before we see this in action, let me explain a few components of this ultrasound diagram. This green line over here marks the region between the hard palate and the alveolar ridge, and it's called a palate spline. And this white marking that you can see is my tongue. So when I say the word level, you can see the movement of my tongue. If I slow this down a little bit, you can see just how my tongue moves. There, the tip of my tongue is almost at the back of my teeth. In comparison, if you listen to an American saying the same word,
level.
And when I slow it down again, you can see how his tongue almost bunches up right over here. This is what is called a dark L. The next question then is, why do these differences arise in the first place?
So that's a really big question. In terms of foreign accents, I think you can say that it's somebody who's using the system and the structure and the sounds of their native language and sort of superimposing that onto the language that they've learned.
One particular stereotype of some communities, such as the Japanese, is that they tend to swap their R's and L's. But that is not the case. These individual sounds don't really exist in their language. The sound that does exist lies somewhere between them. But these differences do not just exist internationally, but quite often within the same country as well.
Here within the UK, we have indigenous languages like Scottish Gaelic and Welsh, and these affect the way people speak, the accents that people have in the northwest of Scotland and in Wales. So I think it's to do with communities being isolated from one another. So it might be geographical isolation, or it could be maybe different social groups even within the same area, but they don't mix very much, and you have an innovation occurring within one of these groups, a different speech sound, and people within the group are talking to one another all the time, so that speech sound travels through the group, it disperses. That's not happening between that group and the other group that's maybe geographically isolated or socially isolated from it. And over time, all these little changes build up and build up, and then you end up with different accents.
The real problem arises when these subtle differences in the way that our tongues move is used as ammunition for discrimination. So I want to take a little bit of a deep dive into these differences in our accents. These differences have influence on your jobs, on your employability, on your interpersonal relationships, and so much more. This is because the moment we hear somebody speak in a manner which is foreign, we tend to form a bunch of biases towards them. Let's do an exercise to prove this. We're gonna have two different speakers with very distinct accents, and I'm gonna ask you to listen to this ad read for a video-sponsored NordVPN in their respective accents. And I would firmly suggest that you do this without any inhibitions. There will be no judgment over here. All you have to do is take a guess as to who they are and what the socioeconomic background could be. The rest of the instructions will be on the screen.
Today's video is brought to you by NordVPN.
Today's video is brought to you by NordVPN.
Imagine having a secure, private connection every time you go online.
That's exactly what NordVPN offers. It hides your IP, encrypts your data,
and keeps you safe from hackers and trackers, even on public Wi-Fi.
With thousands of fast servers across the globe,
you can access content from anywhere with complete peace of mind, knowing NordVPN has your back.
And right now, with their huge Black Friday sale, there is no better time to get started.
Just scan the QR code on the screen,
or hit the link in the descriptions to lock in this special offer,
and protect your online privacy with NordVPN.
Now, I also sent this text to 30 other people back home in India and asked them to give their answers anonymously. And the results for it? Not that extraordinary. So about 28 people responded to the survey, and this is what the results look like. Let's start with speaker one. Most of the people thought that they are from the top 1% of the country and they do belong to England. Now, I'll reveal where they're actually from after we discuss speaker two as well. Majority of the people thought that speaker 2 belongs in the top 10% of the country and that they belong from India. Now, they were correct in predicting that this speaker was from India, but instead of belonging to the top 10% category, the speaker belonged well within the top 1% of the country. And as far as speaker 1 goes, well, none of the predictions really mattered because this was generated by AI. So why did this happen? Well, for that, we might need the help of a branch of linguistics called sociophonetics.
Sociophonetics, particularly, is the study of speech sounds and how you use them to indicate social meaning. Speakers can use incredibly subtle variations in order to indicate something about the group they belong to. It could be to do with their sex, it could be their social class, it could be some other aspect of their identity. So I can give you an example from Scottish English. We have, in central Scotland, we have different ways of producing the R sound. Working class speakers tend to produce R with their tongue tip up the way, which is maybe a more traditional variant, and middle class speakers tend to produce a bunched R, it's called, with their tongue tip down the way. And that was a real surprise to me, and I didn't find out about that until I started looking with the ultrasound at the way people were moving their tongues. Also, the working class speakers delay their tongue tip movement a bit, and they make the R sound weaker and less audible. But it's really surprising, a surprisingly kind of small variation that has social meaning.
Now, this is where my dilemma really sets in. The way that you speak is very personal to you. It's ingrained within you. But all these negative biases towards certain sections of the society really makes me want to rethink the accents and the differences it entails. It was very hard to find any scientific research which highlights the positive impacts of these differences in accents on our society. So I asked Dr. Lawson if she could help me out, and thankfully, the answer was yes.
It's important for people that have regional or non-standard or foreign accents to use their accent while being competent and intelligent, because then the stigma that gets attracted to these accents is lessened a little bit. If everybody starts to acquire a specific accent or a specific way of speaking in order to have a particular form of employment or be in broadcast media, then people start to associate that accent with competence and intelligence, and that just makes things worse for everyone who doesn't have that accent.
And there is a very simple solution to it. We just have to put in a little more effort towards understanding each other.
So we do naturally accommodate over time to people's accent. We get used to people's accents. And I feel if we can hear lots of different examples in media, it makes life better. It makes life easier for people who don't have a standard accent. Yeah, that's how I feel about that.
Accents have another important characteristic. They poignantly reflect the culture itself. As sounds travel, they are adapted and transformed, creating a rich history for itself. In fact, there's a very particular letter in the English alphabet that has journeyed across the globe, gathering stories, gathering influences by adopting to various languages and various sounds. And that is the letter R. Let's take a look at Japanese R again, but this time let's focus on the position of the tongue. This is where your tongue would sit for a type of standard English R. And this is where it would sit for a type of standard English L. But when the Japanese pronounce their variation of R, the tongue sits somewhere in the middle of these two. So while it may seem like they're swapping the R's and L's, they're not. In fact, they somehow pronounce both the R's and the L's at the same time. You can try this for yourself. Try and position your tongue somewhere between where it typically sits for your R and L, and try and pronounce the Japanese R. Here's what it sounds like.
Da, di, du, de, do.
It's not that easy, is it? I guess now you can at least appreciate them for trying.
People who have a non-standard accent, an urban accent, a regional accent, to use their accent when they're in their job and when they're being professional and competent and intelligent, and then it makes life easier for other people who come from these locations because there's less stigma attached to accent. Because when you think about it, the way you move your vocal organs is not an indicator of intelligence or competence. It's literally just the pattern that you have learned. There's no link there. So why should there be stigma attached to particular accents?
I think I have come around on my doubting perspective towards the differences in these accents. Yes, they are very important because they somehow make up who you really are. And that's a good thing. And of course, there's room for humor. I mean, it might seem very contrary, but I don't really mind the stereotypes. I think we have enough reasons to dislike each other in this modern world, and I wanted to normalize this new growing divide that we have by trying to understand why we speak the way we do. Speaking of which, I look like a science experiment, which is nice. So I requested Dr. Lawson if I can hop in and say a few words in their fancy setup. Trap. Trap, thought, thought, goat, price, level and try and form an analysis for this big puzzle of the Indian TND. So this is a spectrogram of me saying the word goat. In order to understand this, all you need to know is that on the y-axis, we have the different frequencies going from lower frequency to a higher frequency. And then on the x-axis, we have the time. Now, this is me saying the word goat. I'll let you listen to it.
Goat.
And this sharp line is my T.
Goat.
Did you catch the T in the end? So the T is very, very precise. Now, if you compare that to a more Western accent.
Goat.
And now in slow motion.
Goat.
Their T is starkly different and much more spread out than the precise T that I have over here. Now, this difference is particularly important because of the sheer contrast between the Indian and the Western T.
Indian speakers often produce is either retroflex or apical. So it involves curling the tongue upside down under the palatal arch, or maybe just pushing the tongue tip up towards the palatal arch to form a closure. And that gives it a very kind of precise quality. But also in doing that, you have to lower your tongue body and retract your tongue body. And that will affect the vowel that that occurs before the tida. So it'll give it more of an ah-ish quality. So arta, arda.
For example, another interesting bit could be the fact that I have a buildup of lower frequencies before I say the sound g. And also the example of level from earlier.
Level.
So there are very peculiar differences in the way that we speak, which is not just limited to T's and D's. So why are just T's and D's usually highlighted? I think I have a theory for it.
I think this is probably the most promising line of thought that I have, in the sense that since your T's are almost like on the way out,
yeah,
in general, and we emphasize our T's quite differently, T's and D's. And so the contrast is probably what makes it so much more of a marker in general, right?
Yeah, there's that. I mean, obviously, we haven't lost our T's at the beginning of syllables, so they're still there. But sounds often disappear at the end of words, at the end of syllables, or they're less clearly articulated, they become more vowel-like. So yeah, that difference is probably very kind of noticeable.
So now that we understand why our T's sound like that, the final frontier is to understand why our T's and D's are swapped.
As Indians, we are often said that we exchange them, like our D's sound like our T's.
Yeah.
In my head, that doesn't really happen, but apparently, that is the case.
I would just reiterate that you're not mixing them up. It's just we have different ways of producing in terms of aspirated or unaspirated, the voice and voiceless. So it's just when you say a voiceless plosive, it sounds like a voiced plosive to us. So your t sounds like a d to us. And that's just because we have different strategies for producing them, for discriminating between a voiced and a voiceless consonant. So it's not your production problem, it's our perception problem. If that makes sense.
It's quite a lot of sense to me. So there you have it, a short overview of foreign accents. I hope with this we can reflect upon how we see others' accents, or at the very least, see how we can develop an actual sense of humor for it. Hey guys, thank you so much for watching this video till the end. I guess if you watched it until this long, you'll be interested in more research regarding this topic. And that's where I would invite you to go and visit Dr. Lawson's research website. There's a few of them. I personally like seeing speech quite a bit. In fact, we have borrowed a lot of material from over there to make this video. They are doing some incredible work in speech therapy, and I would highly recommend that you go over to their website and show them some support. So a big thank you to Dr. Lawson for letting us come over and understand this topic in a much deeper sense. Now, if you would like to show some support for our channel, I would just request that if you like this video, please share it to everyone who you think might find this interesting. The biggest challenge that we have as a small channel right now is that we don't really have enough reach, and YouTube recommendation is a bit of a hit and miss in terms of finding people in the first place. So if you like this content from us, and if you would like to genuinely support us, all I would say is please share this to as many people as possible. That's the best that you can help us out with. Thank you very much for watching again. And I'll see you in a few days.